the debates, the issues, the people. Get it all here on the Michelangelo Signorile Show.
Good afternoon and welcome back to the Michelangelo Signorile Show here on Sirius XM Progress 127. This is Joe Sudbay, guest hosting today for Mike. And right now we have a guest who I think you guys will really enjoy, and he's joined me several times. It's been really fun because I've been able to guest host over the past few months, just about once a month. And over that period of time, I've been able to have David Nir from Daily Coast Elections join me and kind of give an update on what's going around the country on the electoral map. And you can find David, he's the editor of Daily Coast Elections, where you can find him there, DK Elections on Twitter, and sign up for the newsletter because every morning you get it at 8:30. And if you're a political junkie, it's so great when you get it because they got all latest updates on all the key races, what's happening, latest polling, TV ads. It's kind of amazing. David, welcome to the show. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you, Joe. I love being on.
Well, we love having you because it gets us right up to date on what's going on. So let's start. Let's start up in Alaska because there was a primary, Republican Senate primary this week. Tell us how that played out and how it bodes for November.
Sure. So Republicans nominated Dan Sullivan, who is a former state government official up there. He's been a pretty good fundraiser, except his big knock is that he's really something of a carpetbagger. And Alaska is one of these states which takes its identity quite seriously. And Sullivan has spent a lot of time in Ohio and in the D.C. area. He worked for Condi Rice. And Democrats have been attacking him on the air with ads over the fact that he, for example, got a fishing license in Alaska and checked the box saying that he was a non-resident just a few years ago. So he's had a lot of stumbles like that. And Democratic Senator Mark Begich, he faces a very tough race just because Alaska is so red and the president's pretty unpopular right now. But no one can question his Alaska bona fides. The polls have it very tight, and this is definitely one of those races where control of the Senate will come down to based on what happens in Alaska.
Yeah, and Sarah Palin's candidate lost, right?
That's right. Sarah Palin endorsed Joe Miller, a real radical Tea Partier. You may remember in 2010, he beat the Republican incumbent, Lisa Murkowski, in the primary. And then she went on to defeat him in the general election by running this pretty unprecedented write-in campaign. Miller was a big surprise, actually. He finished second to Sullivan in the primary, even though the polls had shown him a distant third. It's sort of too bad. Democrats might have had a chance at boosting him. He would have been the easiest candidate in the general election, but that's sort of what-if territory now, and Democrats just have to worry about Sullivan.
Right. So that's one of the key races. Another key race is Arkansas, and something, I guess, unexpected almost happened with the latest TV ad from Mark Pryor, who's running against Republican Congressman Tom Cotton. Give us an update on Arkansas.
Sure. So Arkansas, again, a very difficult state for Democrats to defend, much like Alaska. It's very red, trending in the wrong direction. Obama, once again, is very unpopular there. Pryor, though, has done a pretty good job carving out a separate identity for himself. And what he did this week, though, was very interesting. Republicans have loved to attack Democratic candidates throughout the country on Obamacare. Pryor ran an ad and is running an ad this week in support of Obamacare. Now, he doesn't actually say Obamacare or the Affordable Health Care Act, but he does tout some of the most popular features of the ACA, such as the fact that insurance companies can no longer deny coverage for people who have pre-existing conditions. And for Democrats to turn this issue around, to turn the ACA from a loser to a winner, this is exactly what they need to do, because it's not popular to tell people, hey, we should go back to the old way of doing things when insurers could boot you at their whim. And so it'll be a really interesting thing to see whether Pryor can make this work.
And also, and I think polling has shown, and the polling I've seen is that, you know, if you call it Obamacare, the numbers are lower. If you call it the Affordable Care Act, the numbers go higher. But if you talk about the individual strands, like what Pryor's doing, it's those individual items have a lot of support.
That's exactly right. And one of the most interesting examples of what you're talking about comes in Kentucky, another state where Democrats are trying to knock off a Republican senator, Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell. They have a very popular state-based version of Obamacare, the expansion through Medicaid, and they call it Kynect, K-Y-N-E-C-T, sort of a cute little play on Kentucky's postal abbreviation. If you call it Kynect, very popular in the polls. Call it Obamacare, forget about it.
And how's that race looking? Because, I mean, we talked about on the show yesterday and a little bit today, Mitch McConnell basically did an interview with Politico where he's laying out his agenda if he's the majority leader, which assumes he wins and the Republicans take control. And it's basically, I'm going to shut down the government. He didn't exactly say that, but anyone who read into it certainly thinks that.
You know, Mitch McConnell constantly seems to be his own worst enemy. I think he's sort of torn between the realities of governing in D.C. and pleasing the extremist base. But the biggest problem for him is that he has been in Kentucky politics for an extremely long time. And people can just wear out their welcome that way. You know, we saw it happen with Dick Lugar in the Republican primary last cycle in Indiana. Several other Republican senators have faced serious challenges from pretty weak candidates just because they've been guys who've hung around so long and compromised so much over the years that invariably you taint your image. Democrats have a good candidate there, Allison Lundergan Grimes. She has raised an enormous amount of money. In fact, she's been outraising Mitch McConnell. The real difficulty there, though, is, again, the demographics. You know, if you have a poll showing Grimes tied at 47-47 with McConnell, it's that last 3% hump to get to the 50% mark that will be very, very hard for her. She has to convince some pretty conservative voters to come to her side. But if you can get anyone to, if there's anyone you want to run against, Mitch McConnell has a lot of negatives you can exploit.
Right. It's just he's such an unlikable character. I mean, I don't know how it's amazing he keeps winning. Because there's just you can see with some of these. I mean, you know, if you're political junkies like we tend to be, you watch some of these guys work and some of these women work and you can see how they could be appealing on some level. I've never seen it with McConnell. I just don't get it. I've never seen his political appeal.
I think you're exactly right. I couldn't agree more.
So let's go to another state that is where there's a open seat, but there's a hope. It's been a Republican open seat, but there's hope that the Democrats can pick it up, and that's Georgia. The polling hasn't been as good there lately. Is that true?
Yeah, that's exactly right. It's sort of a bit disappointing for Democrats. They recruited an excellent candidate in Michelle Nunn, who's the daughter of former Senator Sam Nunn. But for a while, polling showed the race potentially very competitive, but that was really before the GOP primary, and it was a very very hard-fought primary, and Republicans now finally seem to have rallied around their nominee, a wealthy businessman named David Perdue. And ever since he won the runoff, his poll numbers have shot up, and the race has been looking harder and harder for Nunn. But the real attacks haven't begun in the race yet. Right. Of course, Nunn has her vulnerabilities just because she's a Democrat running in a red state. But Perdue is one of these sort of out-of-touch one-percenters. He's super rich. You know, he vacations in places that you and I have never even heard of. And he has had a few sort of gaffes and stumbles based on kind of his cluelessness. So I think there's a record to exploit. He's also one of these guys who's laid off thousands of people because, you know, he's been a CEO of American companies over the last decade or so. So that race, the final story on that race definitely has not been written yet.
And he has a propensity for gaffes. We saw a few during the GOP primary. He dissed one of his opponents because she hadn't gone to college. And, you know, I sometimes think with some of these rich business guys get in, they're so used to being the smartest guy in the room. And it's because they've got all their employees around them that they're not always the best on the campaign trail. So I think let's keep an eye on that one. And also, as you have reported at Daily Coast, the demographics of Georgia have changed. I mean, Obama got about 46% in Georgia without spending a penny in 2012. And the demographics continue to change in a direction that should be good for our side. So,
yeah, no, that's absolutely true. And Republicans definitely need to be afraid of the future in Georgia. As for the present, though, as I'm sure you've talked about and certainly read about, Democratic turnout always suffers in midterm years. So Republicans may have really caught a break here by the fact that their pretty unpopular governor, Nathan Deal, is up for re-election this year, and that the seat came open, you know, again in a midterm year. If these races were happening in 2016, I'd be a lot more scared if I were the GOP.
Right, which actually I think is an interesting subject too, because a lot of the people who are up in 2016 are from Wisconsin, you know, Johnson in Wisconsin, Mark Kirk in Illinois, Toomey in Pennsylvania are from states that are tend to be blue. They caught a break in 2010. And if Mitch McConnell does follow through with this agenda of obstruction and shutting down the government, it doesn't really work well for them. So that's just something to think about as we look for hope 2 years down the road. I want to, there's so many, some of these races are so interesting on so many levels. I want to get to Montana, but let's go to Iowa first because she's a nut. She is crazy. And I don't think people know how crazy she is.
So the she in this case is Republican State Senator Joni Ernst, and she's truly certifiable. She recently was busted for these totally black helicopter paranoid fantasies about a UN takeover of our government and dispossessing people from their farmland and forcing them to go live in cities. I mean, truly, truly crazy stuff. What's been so frustrating there is that I don't think Democrats have as yet done a good job explaining just how crazy she is. You know, in 2010, Harry Reid won this incredibly difficult reelection campaign in Nevada by every day going out there and saying, my opponent is totally nuts. And I think Democrats need to take a page from that playbook because it's not just this UN nonsense that Joni Ernst is spouting. There's a whole lot of other crazy things that she believes, and like the fact that Iowa can disavow federal laws that it doesn't like. And so I think Democrat Bruce Braley really needs to be unafraid and just get down in the muck and tell Iowans what the story is with Joni Ernst.
Yeah, and he needs to start doing that ASAP because there's only 10 weeks left, basically, to get that out there. And let's look at there's two other states kind of in the south, that southern kind of part of the country, where there are Democratic incumbents who are kind of holding on the polls. Let's talk North Carolina first and Kay Hagan. How's she doing?
Kay Hagan is doing a lot better than I would have expected 9 months ago. She was made the Koch brothers' number one ad target over the winter when Obamacare was at its most unpopular. And her numbers definitely took a hit in the polls. But she's since rebounded, and she also is lucky because Republicans really don't have a top-tier nominee. They nominated their state house speaker, Tom Tillis, who's been embroiled in all kinds of stupid fights with the legislature and has passed some very extreme legislation there. And ever since he won the primary, he never got any kind of bounce. And the most recent polls keep showing Hagan with a small but consistent lead. She's always up 2-3 points or so. And I think right now, you know, it's I'd call it a toss-up, maybe with a slight edge for Hagan. And if she holds on, that is critical for Democrats.
Yeah, PPP had some recent polling, public policy polling had some recent polling in North Carolina that had her up a little bit. And PPP is based in North Carolina, and I've seen them just nail race after race in that state, including our referenda on marriage, the marriage ban a couple of years ago. They really seem to get North Carolina as well as any place they poll. So I thought that was a good sign. What about Louisiana with Mary Landrieu? How's she doing?
Louisiana's harder to feel quite so optimistic about. The nice thing, as you mentioned, about North Carolina is that you have a very reliable pollster in PPP that likes to poll their home state regularly. We don't get a lot of good polling out of Louisiana. And what we do have hasn't looked very optimistic for Landrieu. But the final chapter of that race is unlikely to be written in November, and that's because in Louisiana, if no candidate gets 50% in the general election, then there is a runoff in December. And because you have a sort of second minor Republican running alongside the establishment choice, who's Congressman Bill Cassidy, we're very, very likely to see a December runoff. Landrieu had one of these once before in 2002. Karl Rove expected to destroy her. He called it Operation Icing on the Cake. and she pulled a rabbit out of her hat and managed to hang on. Can she do it again now, over a decade later, when Louisiana's become much more hostile to Democrats? It's going to be hard, but we could see a scenario where control of the Senate isn't decided in November and everything gets poured into Louisiana, and that will be nuts.
Yep. I remember that 2002, and that was when Bush was so ascendant, too. It was, you know, he was leading the drumbeat to war in Iraq, and, you know, still people were still in fear of everything. Everyone was still afraid of the orange and red warnings, and it was a complete surprise.
Yep.
So Montana, kind of a train wreck there, but they've got a new Democratic candidate. And I like Amanda Curtis. I've watched her videos. I am impressed with her. I know she's a total long shot, but give everyone a little quick snapshot of what happened out there.
Sure. So Democratic Senator Max Baucus retired, and then he decided to resign to become ambassador to China. And the Democratic governor there, Steve Bullock, nominated his own lieutenant governor, John Walsh, to become senator, and Walsh was going to run for Democrats to hold the seat this November. Walsh destroyed himself because of a New York Times report that exposed him for plagiarizing his master's thesis, which, by the way, was all of 14 pages. I don't understand how you can write a master's thesis that short. In any event, despite the length, he still managed to copy and paste around a quarter of it from other sources. He got totally busted, and his campaign fell apart within a matter of weeks. So he dropped out of the race, and Democrats responded by nominating a young state legislator in his place, Amanda Curtis. She's definitely someone who excites progressives. She is, you know, someone that the base can feel excited about. The problem is Montana is not a very progressive state. It's quite a red state. And to win there, you need to appeal to independents and some Republicans as well. In reality, though, Curtis's biggest problem is the fact that she has almost no time. She, as you pointed out, it's just around 10 weeks to Election Day to raise enough money and put together an infrastructure for a statewide Senate campaign. That is really hard to do, even if you have 2 years, and it is almost impossible if you have 10 weeks.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've talked about a lot of the Senate races. I mean, let's just go to New Hampshire, because it looks like Jean Shaheen's doing pretty well up there, right? I just want to make sure we don't miss any of the big Senate races. But she's doing
Jean
okay.
Jean Shaheen is doing well. I was talking with someone over the weekend, and they asked me about Scott Brown, and I said, what are you talking about? That was last cycle. And I caught myself, and I managed to completely forget about Scott Brown. And he seems to have forgotten what state he's running in, too, because he constantly keeps making these gaffes that show that he is truly not a New Hampshireite and that his heart is in Boston, which is where he's from. And, he just hasn't caught on, and he doesn't seem to care. It's a very strange choice, but Democrats are lucky that that Shaheen is doing well.
Right. And I will just say, and I've said yesterday on the show, and I've said before, and we've talked, he's a masshole. That's what people in New Hampshire think about people from Massachusetts who move up and try to take over. He's a masshole. And every time he mentions Massachusetts or Boston or something like that, he reinforces that. And they're a tough crowd, that New Hampshire crowd. Let me tell you, they're tough. So I what's going on in Kansas?
Kansas, man, that is a fascinating situation there.
So right? That we're even talking about Kansas as in play, sort of, but tell us. Anyways, go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, I mean, I can't believe we're discussing it either. So Kansas has this extremely, extremely unpopular Republican governor, Sam Brownback, who people may remember was a senator. He even kind of tried to run for president at one point. And he won in 2010, and he basically decided to turn his state into this petri dish for some crazy right-wing Freakonomics experiment, where they were going to cut taxes to the bone, and surprise, surprise, the budget revenues completely plummeted, and there have been massive cuts to all sorts of state services, and people have really turned against him. And so it's looking very possible that Brownback will lose the governor's race to a Democrat named Paul Davis. It seems that maybe some of Brownback's unpopularity has kind of tainted the longtime Republican senator there, Pat Roberts. Pat Roberts is one of these guys who, as I was alluding to before, he faced a primary challenge from kind of a pretty scrubby opponent, but barely held him off. And Roberts is accused of going Washington. Roberts had a ton of gaffes himself talking about how he's never really in Kansas, which is completely true. And what's crazy is that there's a three-way race right now. Democrats haven't won a Senate seat in Kansas since the New Deal era, but there is a sort of wealthy, kind of leftish-leaning independent who has been already on air and spending a lot of money. And a new PPP poll showed him sort of, I think Roberts was in the 30s and the Democrat and the independent were both in the 20s. But if it were a two-way race between the independent, a guy named Greg Orman and Pat Roberts, Orman would win. It's so hard to get a read on what's going on there, but it is absolutely fascinating.
Fascinating that, yeah, that Roberts isn't playing. And of course, he was recently outed as not having a home in Kansas. He's the senator from Kansas, but doesn't have a home. And he joked about how he stayed on his friend's recliner when he was there or something like that. Like, so how more out of touch can you be with your constituents?
It's hard. We joked that Pat Roberts' home in Kansas was a timeshare and a lazy boy.
Yeah. So I think we've hit most of the big races. Are there any other races, governor races, Senate races we should keep an eye on that or anything you think that's happening in the House that we should pay attention to?
The other big battlegrounds are definitely going to be in the governor's races. You right. definitely have a chance for some big Democratic pickup opportunities. You know, this is 2010 was such obviously a disaster year for Democrats. This right. is sort of the potential for a bounce back year from that. And so some of these Republican governors who were elected by virtue of the huge GOP wave aren't faring so well right now. Tom Corbett in Pennsylvania is looking like dead man walking. Rick Snyder in Michigan faces a very competitive race. Rick Scott in Florida, another guy facing a very competitive race. And these would all be very big pickups for Democrats. A lot of implications for sort of stopping these runaway radical Republican state legislatures. And also looking ahead to the next census, which is closer than you think, redistricting is going to be huge in all of these states as well. So it's important for Democrats to make gains.
And also, let's not forget, when we're talking about governors, Scott Walker is in a dogfight out there in Wisconsin.
Yep. No, thank you for bringing that one up. He's facing a Democrat named Mary Burke. You know, after the failed recall in 2012, all of the top-tier, most notable Democrats kind of shied away from challenging Walker, and Democrats were able to find Burke, and people sort of weren't sure about her. She hadn't really ever run for office before. She's wealthy, not really self-funding, though. But it turns out that she has been great on the campaign trail, and the polls have shown that race really a toss-up now. So Walker could definitely lose, and boy, would Democrats be excited about that.
Right, right. These governor races, we cannot understate how important they are in terms of the just the powers of governors, and we've seen so much crazy stuff happen from state legislatures that were taken over by Republicans. The other state that I got my fingers crossed is my home state of Maine, where there's a three-way race between the incumbent Paul LePage, who's stuck at about 38% in the polls, the Democrat is Mike Michaud, and there's a third-party incumbent named Elliot Cutler, who is a spoiler in this race. He's polling at about 13%. If he wasn't in the race, it would be a blowout because LePage can't get above 40, I don't think. I saw Angus King. I saw you guys wrote that Angus King endorsed Elliot Cutler this week, and you kind of had some snark about it. And I tweeted, of course Angus King endorsed Elliot Cutler. These rich, straight, white guys stick together, and they both are very rich and very kind of, Elliot Cutler has, what I've been told, has the most expensive property in the state of Maine, private property. And there's a lot of expensive properties up there along the coast, but he's got the most expensive property, but it's owned by his a corporation in Delaware. So that's, you have to be pretty rich to be able to pull that stunt.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. Like you say, the polls of a two-way race show Michaud absolutely destroying LePage. Unfortunately, that's not what we have here. But I think I like Democrats' chances in that state. So for your sake, since it's your home state, I definitely hope we get rid of LePage.
Well, thank you. And thank you again, David Nir, for taking the time again, coming on the show, getting everyone up to speed and keeping everyone up to speed on what's going on electorally. It's only going to get more intense over the next few weeks and the next 2 months. And again, if you are interested at all in American politics, get the newsletter, because at 8:30 every day, you give me a fix, David Nir, and I really appreciate it.
Well, it's my pleasure, Joe, both to give you your fix and to be a guest on this show.
Well, thank you so much. This is Joe Sudbay here on Sirius XM Progress, the Michelangelo Signorile Show. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be back in 2 minutes.
Michelangelo Signorile on Sirius XM.